You can see him on stream as well right now. I think the standouts for me are the Flamigo versus that Alolan Ninetales.
Yeah, we've debated whether Toller's team qualifies as being a Trick Room team. I think we can both agree that Paul's team does not qualify as being a snow team. Certainly has the base requirement of being a snow team and that it does indeed have snow. I think what's fun about it is that, yeah, it doesn't really in any way have any snow team qualities otherwise.
It really doesn't, and that's why y'all don't have to go to the store for the milk and the bread and all that stuff that us or Northeasterners do when snow is in the forecast. Toller's team, if you're just tuning in for the first time this weekend, Golden Go, Incineroar, Flamigo, Ursaluna, Porygon2, and Amoongus. I think most notably the strategy we've seen from people running these teams is that use the Flamigo to remove the big Trick Room counters off the field, Brave Bird into Amoongus, an incredible amount of damage. And once those Pokemon are gone, Ursaluna and Porygon2 really steal the show for themselves.
Yeah, and it was kind of funny where I was looking at the team sheets here, and I was like, oh, you know, I think this time probably what I'm going to say is, oh, there's way fewer Pokemon on the other side of the field for Flamingo to rip through, so maybe we'll see a little different strategy this time. But there's still three things that it has a great matchup with, right? I think it probably says something about how great of a meta call Flamigo was, that, you know, three huge advantages seems not that great compared to what we've been seeing Flamigo match up against throughout the rest of the tournament.
For sure, and with Golden Go and Incineroar as well, I think we've primarily seen Toller rely on the Flamigo, the Ursaluna, the Porygon2, and the Amoongus throughout his tournament runs on stream, but does have some good playability into Paul's team as, you know, the Steel Type attacks from the Golden Go, the Flare Blitz from the Incineroar certainly would threaten that Ninetales if it makes an appearance, but also has some good synergy into some of the other Pokemon Paul Chua has on his team as well. But Toller Web, no stranger to the competitive stage. We have his most recent accomplishments up here, bar one. Got top 64 at Worlds this past year, won the Knoxville Regional Championships last year, and actually ended up playing Paul Chua in day two of Swiss at the Charlotte Regional Championships, where he got top eight.
Yeah, one of those very few players too, as the combination of a regional, national, and world championship, you know, kind of mixing age divisions, and I guess in the case of national championships, a defunct tournament level, but one of the most successful trainers of all over the course of his career.
Well, here's the snow that doesn't really be a snow team from Paul's side of the field, focusing on multi-scale Lumberry Dragonite. We saw that come into play huge for him earlier on in top eight. King Gambit, Alolan Ninetales, Incineroar, Amoongus, and Garchomp rounding out the team.
Yeah, I'm really interested, in, especially in that Ninetales. I don't think I've ever really seen this Pokemon used this way, right? Where even if you don't have like a whole snow-themed team, which tended not to be very good largely in the video game championships, we almost always at least see the Aurora Veil, right? And like, snow is doing something. Certainly it's necessary for Blizzard's accuracy, and there's no weather moves on Toller's side of the field, so you know, we'll at least get to maintain that. But I think it's just a cool use of this Pokemon, focusing solely on its offense and a little bit of support with Encore. And there are three Pokemon on Toller's side of the field who really don't want to be hit with ice type attacks, so hey, maybe we'll see it.
Maybe we'll see it indeed. I think the other Pokemon to keep your eyes on here in this matchup is going to be the King Gambit with the Defiant with Low Kick and the Garchomp from Paul Chua. I feel like Paul's team is a very offensive approach to Regulation H, has many different options he can bring and go on the offense right away, where Toller may have to waste some time trying to find positioning, trying to find speed control. Real quick though, Paul Chua got top 16 at NAIC last year. I think most importantly in terms of his accomplishments was our 2023 European International Champion.
Yeah, I think one last thing in this matchup I find kind of exciting is that usually that Amoongus is such a great counter of a Trick Room team, doesn't actually match up very well with this version of Trick Room. Certainly Porygon there wouldn't especially enjoy playing as Amoongus, but we have Ursaring already on the field, eventually probably going to see a Flame Orb activate and remove its ability to be spored. You know, Incineroar has Safety Goggles, Golden Go could be in the back, although now we see it's not, who has the Good as Gold ability, so a little different solutions required to this version of Trick Room compared to some of the more common Trick Room teams of the past.
And I think having Toller lead the Porygon2 alongside of the Ursaluna gave him the best option to go on the offense immediately to sort of rival what Paul Chua brings to the table here in this matchup. We do see Toller make a bit of a defensive pivot here. Interestingly enough, though, will opt to leave the Ursaluna on the field for this turn, which means it will get the Flame Orb boost to its attacking damage at the end, unless something a little bit strange happens, but I don't think that's what we're going to be seeing here, as Paul Chua opts for the first Terastalization in this top four match, and just like we've seen from him throughout the tournament, going immediately for the Terra Flying typing on the Dragonite.
Doesn't need a little bit of extra boost, you know, there's no like any damage boosting item on this Dragonite, instead opting to have even more powerful Flying type attacks.
Protect will keep this Ursaluna safe, and no fake out from Paltrowa, instead going immediately on the offense. That's a Terra Blast from the Dragonite, targeting down the Incineroar on Toler's side of the field, and a parting shot onto Incineroar's, Toler's Incineroar as well. Haven't seen this move in a while, but I assure you, Incineroar still loves to use parting shot, giving Paltrowa the opportunity to make a Pokemon switch here, opting to send in the Garchomp alongside of the Dragonite.
Yeah, so this is kind of a throwback from older players. We have the double dragon combination. I guess Dragonite no longer a dragon type Pokemon, but still kind of has, you know, the vibe. You noted previously, you know, this Dragonite, unlike some other Dragonite we've seen, has that multi-scale ability, which will reduce the damage of the first attack it takes, however, did not mitigate that Intimidate and will not mitigate a Fake Out, if that should be something Toler is interested in, though. It would be a risky play with Garchomp standing right over there.
It would be a very risky play, as Garchomp certainly is faster than that Incineroar and has plenty of ground moves it can use to deal some super effective damage. That's why we see Amoongus take the field in its place, going to be able to take those attacks a lot better from Garchomp, but a risky switch, as that could have been in line of fire from another Flying-type Terra Blast on this Dragonite. Porygon2 gets the special attack boost from download, so that'll be very helpful for it as we move forward in this match. Earthquake for a little bit of chip damage on both of these Pokemon. Dragonite closing things up with a low kick into the Porygon2. Porygon2 is not a heavy Pokemon, so that doesn't do any damage.
Yeah, it may literally be super effective, but does not do nearly as much damage as a Flying-type Terra Blast would have, although none of them would have been too devastating. And now Toler is in a spot where, hey, it took a lot of pivoting, but if he wants to, he can probably get Trick Room up here, though it may come at a bit of a cost.
It may come at a bit of a cost, and I think that cost will be losing your Amoongus. And Toler goes for the switch here, not opting to lose it at this point, and really has a great pivot with that Incineroar, as without the inner focus, we see Intimidate once again drop this Dragonite's attack, but he also drops the Garchomp's attack one stage. So now this Earthquake, even though it will be threatening damage onto this Incineroar and still does get the KO, it is going to be significantly weakened moving forwards when the Ursaluna tries to make an appearance on the field after maybe the dimensions have been twisted. Here comes the Terra Blast from this Dragonite. Will get boosted by the Terastallization, but is not enough to pick up the knockout, and Porygon2 free to set up Trick Room.
Yeah, what wasn't free was the effort that caused this Trick Room to go into play here. Entire Pokemon feigning, Porygon very low in HP. Ursaluna actually looking pretty good, though likely to get intimidated shortly. And meanwhile, on the other side of the field, Toler's done 0% damage. Paul has done 20% damage to Paul with the Life Orb by Garchomp, and we will now see Toler's first attack of the game. And Trick Room, very important to get up with a Trick Room team like this one, especially with how quick most of Paul's team is, but really going to need to take advantage of this, because that was a huge cost.
I was going to say, like, you're down the Pokemon account, you could even lose an additional Pokemon here. I mean, we know that this Porygon2 has access to recovery, but you're almost forced to go for it at this point in time, as if you are down to your final two Pokemon, even if you have Trick Room on your side. Fake Out will buy some time for Paul. You can keep switching Pokemon around. Of course, Paul's Pokemon all have access to Protect. We do get confirmation of Paul's final Pokemon in this matchup, as his own Amoongus will take the field alongside of the Incineroar. And while we will see Toler go for a Terastallization on that Ursaluna to boost the damage of any normal type attacks here, that might not be enough, as Paltrowa still has the Pokemon advantage. Facade will be the attack of choice, though. Again, benefit from that Terastallization, targeting down the Incineroar, but Incineroar able to hold on with just a little bit of health.
Yeah, it's a pretty big survival there, even though, you know, the Incineroar might not be a critical player in some ways the rest of this match. You know, now able to have that Fake Out threat, potentially, able to potentially switch out again, get another Intimidate out. Ursaluna, the big one, the only Pokemon that's really threatening a lot of damage left in Toler's side of the field. So the threat of an Intimidate staying active is pretty meaningful.
It is pretty meaningful, and I think the other thing you have to keep in mind is that between, we've seen Porygon2 do damage in this tournament, but it's not going to match the amount of damage that the Ursaluna does, and every little bit of damage to this Ursaluna counts, as we see Trick Room slowly losing turns in this matchup. Pollen Puff into the Incineroar will take advantage of the flinching Ursaluna to heal up its health.
Now, the good news is now for Toler is that he's going to get something on this turn, right? Incineroar isn't able to protect, so if it stays in the battle, likely to get knocked out. If not, Going to switch out, cause one of its poor friends to take some damage, although, you know, Amoongus to the other side able to Pollen Puff. Kind of noted in the pregame that Amoongus offensively isn't nearly as good against this team as it normally is because there's not much to spore, but Pollen Puff is pretty annoying, and hey, that could be enough healing to survive another facade.
I was going to say, you know, the way that you stall through Trick Room is you find opportunities to protect, you find opportunities to mitigate damage, and being able to heal your own Pokemon is huge as Facade is able to pick up the KO into that Incineroar. That was a ton of damage from that attack, making it so those Pollen Puffs really didn't matter in the end.
Yeah, so both trainers learning that it turns out that that was a damage roll and Incineroar may or may not survive that. Of course, all attacks in Pokemon, there's a range of damage you can do based on a little bit of luck there. And, you know, well, last match, it seemed like every attack we saw did just not quite enough. Pretty clutch knockout there for Ursaluna.
Yeah, sending in the Dragonite here as well, which is still at full health, which means multi-skill is active. And with only one turn of Trick Room remaining as well, a Dragonite Protect here would be perfect.
Yeah, I think one thing to keep in mind, I guess we move to this side, is that at least for now, Notoja's got to find a way to pivot, get another Trick Room. He's too far behind. But you know, later on, the Amoongus, perhaps on Paul's side of the field, is slower, or that could be a tie as well. If it turns out that Toller's Amoongus is actually quicker than his opponent's, you know, there would be the option later in Trick Room were it to come up again to use a Sludge Bomb to break the multi-scale and then allow Ursaluna to attack. But we're a long way from that opportunity.
We are, but there isn't going to be a Protect on the field from this Dragonite, as Amoongus is more than happy to redirect damage its direction. Can't redirect the Sludge Bomb, as it is, you know, a Grass-type Pokemon that's not affected by Rage Powder, but will be enough to keep this Dragonite in the game for now. We also see a cool interaction there between the Lumberry and the poison status from that Sludge Bomb. May not make a big of a difference here. I think the bigger thing here for Toller is that he did not knock out the Amoongus, but with Trick Room expiring, Garchomp can just come out on the field, and Dragonite at full health can target down this Amoongus for its own KO.
Yeah, huge damage there, and we get down to a 2v2, but when you have a few Pokemon remaining like this, the speed advantage is a huge one, and Trick Room is going to expire at a critical time. Now there's the opportunity to try to get a tail or a Trick Room back up, but it seems a little unrealistic in front of both Garchomp with that Life Orb and all the damage it can do, and the Terastalized Dragonite. So now if you're Toller, you kind of have to make a read, right? Well, if I think that Paul's going to double target this Porygon and try to punish that, I definitely need to at least knock out one of these Pokemon to give myself a chance in this game. Although even then, it could be a little bit bleak on the turn after that one.
Yeah, it's a tough call to make here for sure. And I think honestly, all Paul has to do to preserve his win condition right now is to ensure that the Porygon 2 cannot twist the dimensions. And we'll start by doing a little bit of damage thanks to that Earthquake. Here comes the Terra Blast on this Dragonite. We'll be connecting with the Porygon 2 for the KO. So while Ursaluna did make the correct call here on Toller's side to go for an attack this turn, the big question here is, who did this Facade target? And can Garchomp just return and knock out next turn utilizing Earthquake or maybe even Stomping Tantrum?
Yeah, it doesn't matter. I think Earthquake easily going to pick up the knockout now. I do like that play by Paul, where Earthquake hovers for both options. Causes that not to matter. He's going to take the 1-0 win there. I think even a spread Earthquake would probably pick up a knockout here. But now that there's only one Pokemon on both sides of the field, Earthquake going to do even more damage. Paul should easily take this first one. Very close, very exciting game one, but Paul playing very well.
Yeah, playing very well and being able to manage Trick Room to his advantage. You know, we saw him not have to rely on Protect, not have to rely on stalling out those turns in a more traditional way, able to find enough health on the field, able to time the knockouts perfectly, getting rid of his own Amoongus just when the Garchomp needed to come in.
Yeah, I really like that game by him. I think he did such a great job of pressuring Paul with the combination of those Dragon-type Pokemon that are pressuring Toller. Paul did a great job of pressuring Toller. That, you know, by the time he got the Trick Room up, he'd just given up so many resources, right?
Yeah.
I think Ursaluna actually got quite a bit more out of that Trick Room than I was expecting it to. But even with two clean KOs, one of which may not have happened, right? It needed the damage roll. It just quite wasn't enough. On the flip side, maybe this goes differently. You know, eventually we're going to see the Incineroar barely surviving that facade. And, you know, that was the same facade that eventually did knock it out clean. So if we'd seen the rolls in the opposite order, maybe it's a very different game.
I was going to say as well, Toller did start the this game off with the Porygon 2 and the Ursaluna. I wonder if there's a world where he just starts it off with Porygon 2 and his own Amoongus, being able to redirect damage, being able to set the Trick Room up initially. And while you may have to wait one more turn at that point to get the Ursaluna in on the field safely, you know, we've seen how much damage Porygon 2 can do with Ice Beam, especially into Dragon or Flying-type Pokemon. And losing your Amoongus isn't necessarily the worst thing in the world when its whole goal is to provide you with opportunities to twist the dimensions and to give yourself that advantage.
Yeah, I would definitely like to see Toler change of beliefs there. I'm assuming based on what he led, he was expecting something a little different from Paul. And I think one of the things that complicate this matchup is both sides have a lot of options. I think it's also just a little bit easier in some ways to play Paul's side of his matchup where he's just swinging away, right? He doesn't need to set anything up. He's doing as much damage as he can. We've really seen the power of this Lightport Garchomp having the Earthquake next to a flying Pokemon. We get the nice, brother, are you flying moment with the dragon types. But it really does make a big difference, right? Where you don't have to make so many calls correctly in order to get enough damage on the board to succeed.
For sure. Here we go. This is game number two. And Paul Chua does mix things up with the Alolan Ninetales and the Incineroar on Toler's side of the field. We do see that Porygon 2 in the lead, but his own Incineroar alongside of it.
So this is sort of an interesting situation. Offensively, not exactly what the Ninetales wants to see here, right? I guess it's getting some help from its defense boost from its snow, but a natural type disadvantage with the Incineroar and not immediately able to do anything to mess with either of these Pokemon. It does no Encore, so if, for instance, Toler were to try to fake out the opposing Incineroar, there'd be option of trying to Encore, although I don't know necessarily that makes a whole lot of sense. So I think if you're in Toler's side of the field, you're feeling a lot better this time. I think you're not that concerned about Ninetales in general.
You aren't, and I think the other thing I want to call out is that we saw Toler's own Incineroar's Intimidate go first, which means, I mean, obviously that could be a speed tie. We don't know yet, but if you know, you could go for the faster fake out here, but there really isn't a need to fake out. If you're confident that your opponent isn't going to go for it, knock off into the opposing, Incineroar will get rid of the safety goggles. We see Blizzard connect into a little bit of damage from the Ninetales. But most importantly, Porygon 2 ready and raring to go with Trick Room.
Knockoffs all around, obviously not doing a whole lot of damage, but perhaps a good hint for both players that Amoongus could be lurking in the wings on both sides of the field, enabling a potential spore later, or at least just preventing or preventing them from avoiding Rage Powder and attacking whatever Amoongus his future partners could be.
Porygon 2 does have to watch out for a knockoff of its own, though, as you don't necessarily want to lose the Eviolite right now in this matchup. I find it interesting that Toler set up Trick Room, but now almost feels like he's struggling to find an opportunity for damage.
Yeah, here's the reverse of the previous game, right?
Yeah.
We got exactly the right situation, but it took him a million turns to get there. This time he gets Trick Room quickly, but he can actually do a whole lot. I think probably happier to see, in some ways, Parting Shot, although this allows Paul to switch first. At least on Toler's side of the field, you're going to get a little more time to see what Paul has done when you make your future decisions. But we're kind of just moving along here, right? Trick Room doesn't matter if none of the Pokemon are going to knock each other out anyway.
Here's another adjustment from Paul. It's going to be King Gambit coming out onto the field. Terra Blast into the opposing Alolan Ninetales will break the Focus Sash and a Parting Shot from the Incineroar, giving Toler the opportunity now to make his own pivot.
Avoiding complete disaster there by using Parting Shot on the King Gambit, probably what Paul is fishing for. But one of the advantages you mentioned of the Incineroar speeds there, with this time Toler's Incineroar moving second, avoiding what actually probably could have been very, very bad.
For sure. But I mean, if you want to talk about things that could go bad, both the Amoongus and the Ursaluna that Toler's trying to decide between right now do not want to take an ice type attack. And given that snow is still active on the field, I think that this Ninetales probably just went for a Blizzard. I guess you could Encore, but like Encore into what?
Yeah, I mean, I think for sure Blizzard, right? And you'd be a little scared too. I mean, Ursaluna wants to be status, but if you get frozen before the Burnard activates, you're in trouble.
Well, Ursaluna takes the field. Blizzard happens. Thanks to the Parting Shot, doesn't do him much damage. And for a second, I thought it was about to freeze. Nope, that was just the Flame Orb activating. Toler avoiding disaster on that turn.
Yeah, perhaps everyone's heart stopping for just a moment there. But no, it is the red status, not the blue, and the game status. Toler's tournament's going to continue here, but perhaps not for long. He's going to have to try to get some damage down here. Pretty scary Pokemon on the other side of the field where both of them have like reasonably high defense stats, and both of them can do pretty good damage to this Ursaluna. Ursaluna. I keep trying to call it Ursaring. I'm catching myself.
It's okay. It's okay. Just remember.
I miss it. You know, it was a fun Pokemon.
It was a very fun Pokemon, and I think you and Dewey with Tauros there, we can have some chats about that later. Maybe some artistic renditions of Intimidate lowering the attack of the Ursaluna. I would love to see y'all's interpretation of that as we get our first Terastalization of the game. Dark type onto the King Gambit. Falchua fishing for some big damage here.
And critically, potentially removing its weakness to ground type attacks.
That as well. And here comes a second Terastalization from Toler. In game one, we saw him go for it onto the Ursaluna, but in game number two, it's the fighting type Porygon 2. And I love this adaptation in Regulation H from these trainers, as it allows it to use Terra Blast to deal super effective damage to any Tark type Pokemon. And there's certainly a couple of those on the field. Sucker Punch will not connect with the opposing Ursaluna. Terra Blast from this Porygon 2 will find its target in the King Gambit, and it is going to bring it down just a little bit of health, but I think that's enough chip for this Ursaluna to start doing what it does best.
Yeah, it could pick up a knockout here potentially. Of course, now it's been intimidated, and its health's already been reduced, so you gotta kind of think through, like, do I really want to make this trade? But hey, you know, we're kind of wondering, where's this damage going to come from?
Yeah.
Maybe the sweeper was in front of us all along.
It could be, it could be. And the other thing that I really like about this position, at least from Paul, is that he's once again found a way to sort of ignore Trick Room, if you will. There is the threat of Fake Out on the field right now. Could go for a flinch on either of Toler's Pokemon. We saw the threat of the Sucker Punch in the previous turn, and both those moves just completely ignore the Twisted Dimensions. And I think Paul's done a great job of showing just how flexible his team is in the approach in this matchup.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't really feel like Toler's in a position to get all that much out of his Trick Room.
Yeah.
Turns really whittling down, but it's the Ursaluna who has to flee inside of its own Trick Room. Now on Paul's side, I feel like if you can position in such a way to punish a second Trick Room attempt, it's really looking like the finals are close.
Fake Out will connect with the Amoongus, and Kowtow Cleave from the opposing King Gambit will follow up as well. Not enough to pick up a KO. Will bring that Amoongus down to just below half its health. And with another Terra Blast on the Porygon 2, this time targeting down that Incineroar. It's super effective, but it's just not doing any damage.
And this could be okay. I kind of wonder if on Toler's side of the field, he doesn't want to slow play this a little bit on purpose now. Now, don't give Paul any free switches to get those more offensive Pokemon out once Trick Room expires. Maybe instead try to keep these Pokemon that are kind of struggling to knock out his own Pokemon on the field, whittle them all down a little bit, and then get in a situation where maybe you get a second Trick Room and just start clicking Earthquake and deleting Pokemon.
Yeah, it's going to be a bit of a slow approach here from Toler yet again, but I think this is okay. As long as Paul is unable to really switch out the Incineroar or the King Gambit on his side of the field, he has a few turns here to play around. Could also try and fish for some recovery. There is, you know, Pollen Puff on his own Amoongus. We know Porygon 2 has access to recover, but before we get to any of that, Falchua will be switching out the Incineroar for an Amoongus. Toler Webb making a switch as well, and will opt to send in the Ursaluna.
Sort of interesting, Spidey. I forgot being hinted that both sides had the Amoongus, so neither trainer really having a whole lot of offensive potential here as we see the Spore Whip.
Yeah, the Spore unfortunately will not work on an opposing Amoongus, and Kowtow Cleave from this King Gambit is enough to pick up the KO. So Porygon 2 or the Incineroar could come back into play from Toler, but I'm assuming you don't want to activate your opponent's Defiant ability at this point in time, so it's just down to the Porygon 2.
Yeah, and you know, as much as that maybe is a little bit what Toler is looking for, you know, a chance to get Trick Room back active again, I don't know. I feel like losing the Amoongus there really hurts. I think critically, you kind of want it for later in the game, either to redirect a Sucker Punch to get a Palunpuff off on this Ursaluna, or like probably both. It's kind of asking a lot here. The one advantage that, you know, Paul's side of the field isn't threatening a ton of damage either, but, you know, this Ursaluna's already at half health, and you know, is that going to have to do a whole lot? And this Defiant active, it's only going to take one more attack from the King Gambit if it can somehow find it to take care of this Ursaluna.
Yeah, there will be the opportunity for Toler to go for a flinch here with a Fake Out onto that Pokemon. Could opt to just move faster and go for a Flare Blitz, but with the Amoongus alongside of it, we know there's also no more safety goggles on that Incineroar either. So Falchua has plenty of options here. Can't protect at least, but will not be switching, so will opt to stay in this turn. Will be flinched for its trouble. Facade from that Ursaluna picking up the KO in return, but now the Amoongus on Paul's side of the field, free to target down either of these two Pokemon. could try to put the Incineroar to sleep to try and cut down Toler's moves, and that's exactly what we see.
Yeah, I don't know if I hate that if I'm Toler. Things are a little sketchy, but like we're at least approaching a situation where you can imagine that Porygon actually could try to clean up this game on its own. You know, the problem with the kind of how defensively oriented all of Paul's Pokemon are is going to be pretty difficult to get through recover if Toler can find a way to get rid of probably this Amoongus, although it's going to be tough to deal with now that Ursaluna is going to have to somehow get around Ninetales to attack.
It will have to get around Ninetales, but the Incineroar on his side of the field will be able to take those Ice-type attacks a lot more comfortably. While it is asleep this turn and will remain asleep this turn, as this is the first turn that it has been put to sleep on the field, an early wake-up here from this Incineroar and then a Flare Blitz into either of these two Pokémon would be a great opening for Toler to start to make a comeback. Blizzard from that Ninetales, not going to do a lot of damage, and it's all up to this Amoongus. What did it go for this turn? Is it going to heal up the Alolan Ninetales? And that's exactly what we see.
I mean, I think it's better than a Spore. Could be worse, could be worse.
Yeah.
But not ideal, right? And now there's a full Amoongus still sitting there. On Toler's side of the field, I feel like if you get a quick wake up on Incineroar, there's definitely still a path here, but the key is going to be removing this Amoongus quickly enough that you can then pivot in a position where Porygon can heal itself up and win the game.
Encore from this Alolan Ninetales will connect with the Incineroar, and you have to remember what was the last attack it used successfully. That was
fake out.
Would
have happened, but the Encore is going to save the game.
Yeah, fake out will not work as it has been on the field for a couple of turns. Return will bring this Porygon 2 back up to full health, but Amoongus is right behind it with another Spore.
Yeah, I mean, it's not over yet, but wow, that's just such a huge swing, right? Without Encore, Incineroar gets a Flare Blitz off, most likely into the Amoongus, either knocks it out clean or gets very close. Now instead, you're in a situation where you're stuck faking out for the rest of the game, potentially, at least until you make a switch. Ninetales sitting here going to Blizzard. You really can't switch out because you're just going to lose your Ursaluna, so kind of no choice but to sit here and take it.
And I think that's what's really cool about this Alolan Ninetales from Paltua. It reminds me of, you know, the Whimsicott pressure that you see, but instead of being a supportive option for the team, you just have incredible offensive synergy with the snow warning, with the blizzards, and then if your opponent does use Fake Out in front of the Alolan Ninetales, you can immediately punish that play.
Yeah, the Encore is just so good there.
It really is!
Really smart play by Paul, too. I think it's easy to get greedy and like kind of just not play around the potential for a minimum turn sleep there. Does exactly the right thing. And yeah, I think I just don't know what you do on Toler's side of the field.
I mean, you hope that your Pokemon wake up and try and go on the offense at some point in time, but a second Encore from this Alolan Ninetales will ensure that there really is not much damage coming out on Toler's side of the field. And while he may have wanted to try and twist the dimension so he wouldn't have to worry about Encore in the future, it's instead recover that he's locked into now that DP2 has waken up.
Yeah, to me this looks pretty over here. Where I just don't know how you avoid the situation where Incineroar either gets knocked out or switches out and allows its friend to get knocked out, and then as soon as it comes back, immediately gets taken care of again. There's a real threat of Paul running out of PP for Blizzard, which is a unique problem. I don't know that I've ever mentioned a VGC match for, but it doesn't matter, right? There's still a secondary attack on the Ninetales, and you know, Porygon being stuck recovering for the rest of the game. As much as that was sort of Toler's win con, it did need to eventually weave attacks in there, and I just don't know how that's going to happen now.
I'm not sure either, but Toler is trying to find that win condition, and I think another cool thing that Paul's doing here is that he's actually not using Blizzard so that he doesn't have to worry about running out of those power points, the number of times he can use those moves, and it's a very, very slow end game here, but this is what Paltua does best. Like, I feel like every single time we see him in one of these high-stake matches, he's able to manage the board position and really just systematically shut down the options that his opponents have.
Yeah, I guess the good, in air quotes, news for Toler is now that the snow has gone away, so Blizzard could miss, but also freeze dry is there.
Yeah.
So we may see the adventures of Sweeper Amoongus as we very slowly get to a position where Paul can then pin and knock out this Ursaluna, but Encore's really just set Paul in a position where there doesn't seem to be any outs. Beautifully played game, and one of the stranger end games I can recall seeing on stream, but you really see why Paul's such a master.
You do, and recognizing that the Alolan Ninetales, you know, has other ways to play it, looking for that creativity options, looking for ways to use Pokemon that we recognize, but in ways that are new and exciting. And that's what it takes to be a multi-time regional champion and be fighting for your opportunity to add one more to your resume. It'll take one more attack to knock out this Incineroar, as it was able to hold on through that freeze dry. But oh, don't worry, it's finally going to be KO'd by a Pollenpuff. Amoongus getting a knockout in the game.
Noted offensive dynamo, Amoongus getting it together. And I guess the good news here is that at least Porygon's not encored anymore. But I feel like the play here is you just use your freeze dry on the Ursaluna, you score the Porygon, and then it doesn't really matter what happens here. And your Ursaluna can't protect in front of the Ninetales, just going to be encored, and Porygon not going to be able to one-shot either of these Pokemon to avoid a Spore, even if it wakes up.
Yeah, the one benefit, I guess, to Porygon 2 being encored into those recovers turns ago is that if Toler does opt to go for Earthquake here to try and get some spread damage on the board to break the Focus Sash potentially temporarily on the opposing Ninetales, you know, you're not necessarily sacrificing your Porygon 2 in order to accomplish that, but at the same time, you really got to think to yourself, if I am able to hold on through a freeze dry, do I take out the Amoongus and try in 2 versus 1 the Alolan Ninetales, or do I focus on the Alolan Ninetales, which is going to be doing damage here? And also, by the way, Paulchua still does have the Incineroar in the back of his party to just further give himself one more piece in this game. Intimidate will lower the attack of the Ursaluna a little bit, so you got that working for you too. But here comes that freeze dry. It comes into the Ursaluna, and it is able to pick up that KO. So Paulchua now a 3 Pokemon advantage here against the sleeping Porygon 2 on Toler's side of the field.
And bad news, I know what move it used most recently.
Yeah. It was Recover, right? I gotta check my notes on that one. Unfortunately for Toler, just the options are running out. Will be encored once again. Paul cheering for his opponent, celebrating Toler's top 4 placement here at the regional championships. But we're still gonna have to wait a few turns for this game to wrap up, as Knockoff will at least remove the Eviolite. That is the item that boosts Porygon 2's defenses pretty significantly in this matchup. So we're still in this.
Yeah, Incineroar doing its best to help put us out of our misery here by increasing the damage that it takes. I see the Recover. The good news for all of us, Toler, Paul, humanity as a whole, Recover doesn't have as much PP as it used to have, so eventually the Recovers will stop.
You know, That's good. Thank you for sharing that information here. And I'm curious what win condition Toler is trying to find his way for moving forwards. I mean, I guess you can hope that your opponent runs out of freeze-dry attacks, but at the same time, you're probably going to run out of recover first, as there's still 3 attacking Pokemon that you have to contend with on Paul's side of the field. And, you know, even though, sure, when you go on the offense with your Porygon 2, the Terra Blast will pick your higher attack stat to do the damage with, I don't think it's necessarily going to make too much of a difference here. And I mean, we could even consider timer rules here, but with Paul with the significant Pokemon advantage, that's not necessarily a win con for Toler.
Maybe he knows Paul has an early flight?
Maybe, but we do see Toler Weblock in the forfeit. Paulchua, a very commanding win in that game number 2. Moving on to the regionals finals here in Baltimore.